Here we go. Hello, people are starting to join. So welcome everyone to our webinar with New York Times columnist and author Roger Cohen. My name's Liam Gautroy. I'm the Executive Director of NIF Australia, and I'll be joining you tonight for this conversation with Roger. I want to particularly welcome and thank for joining people who are joining an NIF event for the first time. By way of introduction, NIF is a partnership between Israelis and diaspora Jews who are committed to a just and democratic future for Israel. And over the last 35 years or so, NIF has supported civil society organizations working on issues like social justice, human rights, religious freedom, and shared society to the tune of almost $400 million over the last 35 years or so. And in Australia, we're committed to creating the kinds of pluralist and progressive conversations that, like what we're doing tonight, and also in other ways like our Nomi Chazan Fellowship, which we launched only a couple of months ago. So we'll get started. I'll start and I'll introduce Roger, and then I'll tell you a little bit more about how we're going to operate tonight. So Roger is one of the world's foremost commentators on foreign policy, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, global Jewish affairs, and global anti-Semitism. He writes a twice-weekly column for the New York Times, was previously a foreign editor at that newspaper. Now he's based in New York. And Roger's recently, he's written a number of very critically acclaimed books, but his most recent, and we'll talk about it at the end, is The Girl from Human Street, Ghosts of Memory in a Jewish Family. So tonight, Roger and I are going to talk about a few issues. If you have a question, you can click on the Q&A button, which is on the bottom of your screen if you're on a Mac or PC, or it's on the top left if you're on an iPad. Or you can join our Twitter conversation as well using the hashtag NIFRoger. And so you can ask your question there about as we go along, and we'll bring that in. The last thing I want to say before we kick off is that obviously we're using the internet. It can be a little bit temperamental sometimes, so hopefully we won't have any technical issues, but hopefully if we do, you'll bear with us while we fix them. So let's jump in, and the first thing I wanted to ask you, Roger, was about the Iran deal, and it's something that you've come out in support of. And the deal between the West and Iran. So I wanted to give you a chance to talk about, to give an overview of the deal as you see it, and what the framework is that's brought about the deal and why you've come out in favor of it.
Well, first of all, hi, Liam. Hello, everyone. Thank you for inviting me to this webinar. I was supposed to be in Australia at this time on what would have been my first visit, but for various reasons had to postpone that pleasure. So I hope to be able to make it to Australia soon, and thank you for inviting me to this. Well, the Iran deal, it's a tough one. It's not ideal. I think many of us, most of us, would wish that Iran had not mastered the nuclear fuel cycle, but it has, and you can't bomb knowledge out of people's heads. So the question becomes, what to do about this program that exists. And I think what Secretary of State Kerry and the President have been able to achieve over the past 2 years is, for the first time in more than a decade, to not only freeze the program, but put it into reverse. Because the deal, as it stands, and remember, this is not just the United States and Iran. This is the United States, Britain, France, Germany, Russia and China. They've all concluded that this is the best deal one can get. It's gotten rid of all of Iran's 20% enriched uranium, that's to say the uranium closest to a state where it could have been used to produce a bomb. It's radically reduced the number of operating centrifuges from close to 20,000 to about 5,000 under the deal. It allows for inspections, international inspections, of an intensity that's unprecedented. It cuts off the plutonium route to a bomb for Iran. In short, I think the deal, while not ideal, ring fences the program in a way that would have been impossible otherwise. And of course, with any deal, you have to ask, what's the alternative? And I think we know the alternative. The alternative is what's been happening in Iran for the last decade. That is a continuous buildup of the number of centrifuges, of its stockpile of enriched uranium, and a steady progress toward a position where Iran would be able to produce at least one nuclear bomb. And none of the opponents of the deal, in my view, They all said we can do better than this, we should have increased the sanctions. No, if this deal falls apart, Russia and China, at the very least, are going to conclude that the United States is unserious, and my prediction would be that the sanctions regime would fall apart. So I think the likelihood of war, and remember, the United States has been at war in Iraq, in Afghanistan. If the United States goes to war in Iran, that's a swathe of 2,500 miles of territory across the Muslim world where the United States has been at war. And then try telling the Muslim world that we don't have anything against Muslims, really. It's just panned out that way. I think it would be a disaster to go back into a situation where war was looming.
So obviously there's been quite a fractured relationship as a result of this. Israel's come out very strongly against the deal, and that's created a lot of tension between the Israelis and the Americans, or the Israelis perhaps, and all of the negotiating parties, like you said. Why do you think that's happened? And David's asked a question through the webinar. Why has Netanyahu come out so against the deal, given the acceptance of it by all of Israel's strongest allies?
Well, look, this is a very divisive deal. It's divisive not only between Israel and the United States, it's divisive within the Jewish community in the United States, and perhaps we'll get to that. And it's divisive between the White House and the Congress, the Republican-dominated Congress in the United States. As you know, Prime Minister Netanyahu has been opposed to this deal right from the get-go, pretty much any deal, really. The Prime Minister initially demanded complete dismantlement. That ain't going to happen. You're not going to get complete dismantlement in Iran. This is a point of pride for the Iranians. Think what you may of it. But it's a bit like oil was in Iran in the 1950s when Prime Minister Mossadegh came along in Iran and said, hey, we've got oil. We think we can actually run our own oil industry rather than have it run by the United States and Britain. And the CIA didn't think that was a good idea. And along with MI5, MI6 at the time, got rid of Mossadegh in a British and American instigated coup. So look, I don't think dismantlement is on the table. More recently, Prime Minister Netanyahu has said, you know, we could get a better deal, we could get Iran to stop all its bad behavior before a deal. I don't want to belittle, obviously, in Israel, for understandable reasons, there are very strong feelings about this, particularly under President Ahmadinejad, but even since, you've had vile, unconscionable statements about Israel being made by Iranian leaders. And you put those kind of statements together with a nuclear program, and you get a pretty understandably strong response. But as I said, I think the question for Israel, if the assessment were rational rather than emotional, becomes, okay, I mean, Iran has this program. India is nuclear armed. Pakistan is nuclear armed. Russia is nuclear armed. Israel, as we know, is nuclear armed. And you're sitting in Iran, you look east, north, west, you see all this. It's understandable that Iran says it doesn't want to develop a bomb. I don't personally find that credible. I think it certainly wants threshold technology, and it's pretty much there. So the question becomes, how do you prevent them from getting a bomb? So I think the Prime Minister's reaction in many ways is understandable, but I think it's misguided. I think this is the best option open to Israel. Iran is a long way from Israel. The Islamic Republic, in fact, for all the rhetoric I just mentioned, has survived through pragmatism, in fact, through caution. It's been a fairly cautious regime. And you know, I've been in Iran more than once, and I tell you, for the average Iranian who tends to be pro-Western, the question of Israel is a faraway issue. I don't think the average Iranian thinks about Israel more than once a year.
So what's Netanyahu's tactics with this, do you think? Do you think he's trying to push to get a better deal, or do you think he's being trying to wedge Jews in America, or wedge Republicans and Democrats? Do you think he's trying to just show strength domestically? What's his kind of game plan? Because it looks like...
Well, he's trying to portray himself again as the savior of the Jewish people, and he views this as an existential threat to Israel, and so he's trying to stand up for what he sees as the long-term interests of the people of Israel. I think his immediate goal then is pretty simple. It's to torpedo this deal in the Congress. As you know, there's going to be a vote of a resolution in the House and Senate on the deal. That, in all likelihood, will reject the deal. The president has made it very clear that he will veto this. And then for the Congress to override the veto would require a two-thirds majority. And that would require roughly a 25% defection in the House and the Senate for the president's veto to be overridden. I don't think that's going to happen. It's not impossible. But of course, it's a very messy way to a momentous and historic deal. It would not be a united America adopting this deal. But I think what the president, what Prime Minister Netanyahu is clearly trying to do is to, I mean, there's intense lobbying from AIPAC, there's intense lobbying from the Israeli ambassador to the United States. They are going congressman by congressman to try and get those two-thirds that would override a presidential veto. I don't, as you know, you've had Jewish representatives, senators going one side or another. You've had Representative Nader on one side, Senator Schumer on another, both say, or Representative Levin from Michigan, who has read the deal closely and has said, in all conscience, I, as a representative here in the United States, as a Jew, I believe this is in the best interest of Israel. It's not in a perfect world what you'd hope for, but diplomacy deals with the real world. What do you want? What do I want? What can we agree we both want? And two very influential members of the Congress, in Representatives Nader and Levin, both Jews, have said they believe this deal is the best that can be gotten. Senator Schumer from New York has come down in a different position.
So one of the things that's been at play with particularly those two representatives that you've spoken about is allegations of anti-Semitism in kind of in the comments being made against them. The Simon Wiesenthal Center released a statement about the some of the comments directed at Senator Chuck Schumer. They said the spectacle of labeling Senator Schumer and other opponents of the deal as warmongers who are more loyal to Israel than America is the lowest form of gutter politics seen in our country since Joe McCarthy. Whereas on the other hand, the Anti-Defamation League came out and condemned attacks on Democrats who have supported the deal, including Congressman Nader. And so they, he's had comments on his Facebook page calling him a stinking capo and being called a traitor to the US and Israel. So this is an interesting dynamic, that there seems to be these accusations of anti-Semitism against those who are opposed to the deal, like Senator Schumer, and those who are in favor of it, like Congressman Nader. So can you explore a little bit about what that tension is and how that's...
Well, I think in what you've just cited, Liam, you see the vitriol. And that vitriol reflects what? Reflects the most divisive issue in the American Jewish community in a very long time. And this is dividing not only the community, it's dividing families. I have cousins in Cleveland who are pretty much divided on this. And I felt like saying when I read that Representative Nader had been absolutely astounded by how vitriolic and offensive the attacks on him had been, I felt like saying welcome to the club. Because, you know, when I, as you know, I'm a Zionist, I'm a strong supporter of Israel, but I'm not a supporter of the policy of expanding the settlements. And I do believe very strongly that a two-state outcome is very much in Israel's interest. It takes two to tango. We can maybe get to that later. But I, and believe me, there is no issue like this. There's no issue like Israel-Palestine in terms of stirring up really very, very vitriolic feelings on both sides. And the Iran issue has brought that to the fore. Look, to call people on either side of this, I think absolutely that people in good conscience, in good faith, can come down on either side of this. You know where I stand, And I find it hard to understand in many ways how it's possible. If you've really looked at it deeply, if you've looked at the history, if you've looked at what's in this deal, if you've looked at the 2 years of negotiations, if you consider the seriousness of Secretary Kerry, of the president, if you consider the five other nations that I mentioned that are involved, and not to believe that this is a serious deal with serious potential. Iran is the only top 20 economy in the world that is not integrated in the global economy. It's a young society. It's a hopeful society. In the best case scenario, you would condemn Iran and the United States to a relationship, hostile, difficult, but a relationship for the next 15 years. What's going to happen as a new generation emerges in Iran? The supreme leader is in his late 70s. It's possible. You can't bank on it, but you can't take it to the bank. But it is very possible that things could evolve in a positive direction. But getting back to what I was saying, look, in good conscience, people can come down on either side of it. This calling of people on either side of it anti-Semites, this is the cheapest shot out there. I mean, there are people in good faith who care deeply about their Jewishness, about Israel, who may take different views on this. I'm not surprised at all that we're hearing the kinds of things you mentioned, because feelings boil over on this issue. And I've seen it in response to things I've written, and I see it all the time, and it's very unfortunate. Look, J Street, which is the liberal Jewish organization in the United States and the only one to come out in support of the deal, last year it wasn't even admitted to the association, if you like, of Jewish communities in the United States. The other communities declared that J Street didn't meet the standard. Well, look, what have Jews done throughout their history and prospered? They've argued, they've differed, they've moved forward in a cacophony of voices. That, if you like, is the essence of Talmudic exchange, of the way Jews argue and live through argument. So that's a sad reflection on the situation in the United States in some ways, in my view.
So I wanted to tease out that little bit of more about the kind of inside Jewish community baseball that's existing, where virtually every, like you said, except J Street, Jewish organization has come out against the deal. And like you said, they've been very prominently lobbying against it, going from congressman to congressman to try and have there be no prospect, or having the possibility of a veto override. And yet American Jews, one survey, I think it was commissioned by J Street actually, said that about more than 60% of American Jews supported the deal. So what do you think that plays, what future then do these organizations have, given that they're coming out very strongly against a position that probably most of their constituents have?
Well, as I said, there are a lot of different opinions, and there have been a lot of different surveys. That one came out the way you just mentioned, with a majority in support of the deal. And I think probably in the American Jewish community, if you took everybody, practicing, religious, non-adherent people who just call themselves Jews because they were born Jews but don't live their Jewishness in any way whatsoever, even perhaps not observing the high holidays, I think probably a majority is in support of the deal. But of course, the major communities like AIPAC represent more conservative, generally older, more committed Jews who think a lot more, spend a lot more time in Israel, perhaps think about it more often at least. And so what you see reflected in these communities is that particular tranche of the Jewish community. I think over time, and that explains the emergence of J Street in recent years, I think over time, if those major Jewish organizations in the United States see their role simply as Israel no matter what, supporting Israel in all circumstances, without criticism, without constructive criticism, I don't think their future will be very bright. I think they have to try to reflect a broader spectrum of views over time. Do I think that's going to change fast? I don't, Liam, because these organizations are well-funded. They have very active support. Nevertheless, J Street has grown substantially. I mean, you have AIPAC now coming out with an ad campaign, and they probably have a budget of over $20 million to lobby against this deal. J Street is working with a number that's maybe a quarter of that. Still, J Street has also managed to raise significant funds to be able to lobby in support of the deal. So, you know, that's a fact of life in the United States. The major Jewish organizations tend toward the more conservative side and tend not to be increasingly, I think, representative of the whole spectrum of Jewish life in the United States.
So I think that's what you touched on is interesting. And there's a couple of questions and comments about what it's like within Jewish communities in the diaspora to be critical of Israel, and that there seems to be this camp of I support Israel, right or wrong. And then on the other side, this Israel is always wrong, and this charting of a path in the middle where you can discuss what it's like to be pro-Israel but critical of some of its policies is a really important third way to chart. And J Street's doing that. I think NIF is part of that community as well. And such a very interesting dynamic that's emerging.
I think that's a very important, third position, if you like, to have. And, you know, it's interesting for me, having worked, I mean, I, you know, spent 10 years in New York, then I moved to London, where I mainly grew up, and I moved back after 30 years for 5 years and worked in Europe. And I've just come back to the U.S. I mean, by way of background, like, my parents were South African immigrants in Britain, and then I grew up in South Africa, but mainly in Britain, and became a U.S. citizen about 10 years ago. But it was really interesting to me moving to Europe. I mean, here in the United States, if anything, you say Roger Cohen, if people have heard of me, they would say kind of, oh, yeah, he's kind of critical of Israel. In Europe, most of the criticism I got tended to be from the other side, because I would say, I'm a Zionist, and you could hear an almost visible intake of breath as the shock registered, because Zionism in Europe has become pretty much a dirty word. And the position I take of strong support for Israel, strong support for the need for a Jewish homeland, but a Jewish homeland that has a little bit lost its way in a very difficult neighborhood, and for which the now very long occupation has been a very corrosive thing, that position of support with criticism meets a different kind of dismay depending on which side of the Atlantic you're on. If you're on the US side, it's why are you so critical of Israel? If it's in Europe, it tends to be why do you support Israel so much? And why do you dare still call yourself a Zionist? I think the need for that kind of position is, well, I would, wouldn't I? Because it's mine. But I do think the need for that position is real, because it's very important to me that Israel be there, that a homeland for the Jews exists. But if you are always just telling the Israeli leadership, you know, you have people in the Israeli government right now, a right-wing government, who are still in a position of decades ago of kind of, oh, the Palestinians, they're not real, are they? Do they exist? You know, why don't we just annex, you know, 80%, 90%, just these numbers from nowhere? But what about the people who live there? Oh, well, you know, move them to Jordan or find some, or, you know, all the land between the Mediterranean and the Jordan River is ours. Well, why is it ours? Because it is. Because it is. What do you mean, because it is? Because it was, I don't know, decreed to the Jewish people in all eternity in the Bible. But, you know, 4 million other people live there. So these kinds of, you know, it's a, as we've already seen, it's a very, these are very explosive issues. I think the need to be able to support and criticize, support and talk, even change your view, you know, maybe, yeah, and then you have movements like BDS, of course. I don't support BDS. Some people do. Boycott, divest, and sanction Israel. I, for various reasons, don't support that. But some do. And, you know, there are people like Peter Beinart here in the United States who has a very similar position to mine. I think we differ slightly on BDS. So there are all kinds of shades of opinion. And I think it's very important that those opinions be expressed and that the arc of civility be extended. Let's extend the arc of civility, the arc of reasonable exchange, and try to push to the margins the vitriol, the insults, the denigrations that we're hearing in the current debate.
I think those are all very good points. And NIF doesn't support the BDS movement, but it's to some there is a kind of shades of grey issue where the fact that you're critical of Israel, even if you don't support BDS, is just as bad. And I think there needs to be that nuance. And I think there's a good opportunity to shift a little bit more to talking about Israel and the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, which is obviously closer to the core work of NIF. And so the first thing I wanted to talk about was this price tag attack phenomenon that exists in Israel of Jewish extremists taking revenge against, or taking vigilante action against, Palestinians, sometimes as a way of getting back at Israeli government decisions like limiting settlement growth, and other times just because, in many cases, because they're driven by that zeal that comes out of public officials like what you mentioned. And the most recent, of course, was the death of two Palestinians in the village of Duma early this month. So how do you think this has developed, and particularly why this is a product, many would say, of Israel's ongoing occupation in the West Bank? And so how is that feeding into internal Israeli society?
Well, you know, Liam, people talk a lot about the status quo in the Israeli-Palestinian situation. And what do we mean when we talk about the status quo? I think we really mean a kind of low-level war, a low-level conflict. And the low-level conflict can express itself in the kinds of incidents you just mentioned, the so-called price tag war, exacting a price for every perceived insult or from the Palestinians or indeed from the IDF. Or it can express itself in three Gaza wars in the last 6 years. I mean, I was in Gaza in December, and a Palestinian was with his nine-year-old daughter, and he just turned to her and said, look, she's nine, and she's seen three wars since the time she can remember, from age three. I don't really need to teach her anything. She knows. She's learned. I mean, her view of Israel has been formed. So, kick the can down the road, status quo, that is going to express itself at some point in violence. The forms of violence change. Right now you have the price tag war, you have killings on a small scale. The last Gaza war, there was the loss of over 2,500 lives. That was somewhat bigger. And two Gaza conflicts before that. Why does this situation produce that? Because it's a factory to produce zealotry. It's a zealotry producing impasse because you have the lives of 2.5 million Palestinians on the West Bank being run by Israel, in essence. I mean, every movement of a Palestinian in the West Bank is controlled by Israel, and that expresses itself in different forms of oppression, humiliation, day by day. And at the same time, you have a growing settler movement that, I mean, some people are in the West Bank because it's convenient, the price is right, but the body of the movement, its essence, is the people who believe, this is Jewish land, this is Israel's land, and must be forever. And any sign they see of hesitation from the Israeli government about continuing to grow the settlements, freeze the settlements, this is a provocation for them. And more or less anything the Palestinians do to try and reclaim land or reclaim olive groves. This is also seen as a provocation. And you also have 1.5 million Palestinians in Gaza living in what David Cameron, the British Prime Minister, fairly recently called an open-air prison. And that's more or less what it is. And there's no way out. Conditions are appalling. And that's not going to diminish the influence or the recruiting power of Hamas. I mean, if Hamas was dreaming up an ideal scenario to get young recruits, Gaza is probably it. So, you know, people who say, well, and I think this is the position of Prime Minister Netanyahu, we can live with this, we can gradually make conditions better for the Palestinians. We can't get to statehood because we can't, but we can live with this. You're really saying you're going to live with violence, and that Israel, for all its immense achievements and its incredible successes and modernity and its real democratic nature west of the 1967 lines. Israel is undemocratic, obviously, to the east of those lines, but within Israel, it is an amazing success story. But its foundation remains shaky. Why is it shaky? Because Israel doesn't know its borders, there's no resolution, and the violence, we can be sure of, will flare.
So that's a good segue into the next part of the question, which is about, I guess, the negotiations that have stalled, more or less. Ari Shavit wrote a couple of weeks ago on the 10th anniversary of the disengagement from Gaza that he says the real danger to Israel isn't from an occupied region it has withdrawn from, i.e. Gaza, but rather from the occupied regions it hasn't withdrawn from, which is the West Bank. And I think a lot of people who are tuning into this webinar and a lot of supporters of NIF more generally would be sympathetic to that view. So if we take Shavit's point and a question from David here in the Q&A plays into that, is he asks, is there any hope still for a two-state solution, or is the reality going to lead to a binational state originally proposed by Mapam going back to 1948? So where do these negotiations go from that have been, stalled since last year?
Well, Liam, you were very kind. You said they were stalled more or less. I would take out the more or less. I think that as definitively stalled as talks can be, it's a very bad moment for anybody like myself who believes that a two-state outcome really is the only viable outcome and must be pursued. As you know, Secretary Kerry made a very intense effort to move in that direction, involving 28 visits in a pretty short period that more or less ended in April of last year. And very shortly after that, and this shows you the consequences of failed leadership, failed negotiation, the Gaza war blew up. And at that point, the Palestinians more or less decided to go a unilateralist course of trying to pursue their interests through recognition of Palestine by Western governments, through the United Nations. I don't think that approach is fruitful. I don't think it leads anywhere. So right now, it's very hard to see how the peace talks can be revived with this current right-wing government in Israel and with the Palestinian movement very frustrated with the expansion of settlements that took that route and that remains, for all the talk of reconciliation with Hamas. There is no reconciliation. When you're in Gaza, the Palestinian Authority does not exist. I saw that firsthand about 9 months ago. And Abbas is a reviled Mahmoud Abbas. Abu Mazen, the Palestinian leader, is a reviled figure in Gaza. So there are a lot of problems on the Palestinian side too. Look, I don't think there's a lot of talk of one state. I don't think, look at Syria, look at Iraq, I don't think the record on multi-ethnic states right now in the Middle East looks too good. You can't have a state whose celebration of its day of independence and whose celebration, whose marking of a cataclysm, the Nakba, is marked on the same day. You know, feelings run too high between Palestinians and Israelis, Palestinians and Jews, right now for that to be feasible. I mean, I think you have to try to get to two states, and then you hope that over the ensuing 50 years or a century, the border becomes as meaningful as the border between Germany and Poland or France and Germany is today within the European Union. What happens in one state? What happens in one state is that Israel can't remain Jewish and democratic. Why? Because they're going to be eventually more Arabs than Jews within that one state. And what are you going to do? How are you going to remain democratic and a Jewish state in those circumstances? So I think the imperative of trying to reach a two-state outcome is absolutely manifest. But it requires statesmanship. It requires leadership. It requires what? It requires being able to say, tomorrow, we'll never have the same narrative on what's happened since 1948 or what happened in 1948. Our narratives are going to diverge completely. But what's more important, proving some historical point over what happened during those 67 years now, or putting the future before that and saying, we can have these differences, but we can live side by side with each other in peace and security. And in fact, we could have a pretty good life given where the Israeli economy is, where Israeli technology is, and given the immense capacities also within the Palestinian community. We can move forward, but it requires looking beyond tomorrow. It requires getting over petty calculation. And I don't think either Prime Minister Netanyahu or President Abbas has shown that leadership. It's very simple in the end. They weren't prepared. They weren't sufficiently interested in getting over the status quo that we've just discussed to move forward. And so we had war, a nasty little war, now a year ago exactly. And we have the kind of intermittent killings, violence, that we're seeing today.
So one of the questions in the Q&A, and so I think if you can deal with this reasonably quickly, maybe, is that the question of, you said Netanyahu and Abbas are both, at least at the moment, not interested in pursuing negotiations towards two states, but whether at all Bibi believes in a two-state outcome. And Jonathan in the Q&A asks, so isn't it clear that Netanyahu does not believe in two states and that the right wing grows stronger every day as the birth rates of the Haredim is far greater than those of liberal and secular Israelis?
Well, I'm not in Prime Minister Netanyahu's head, after all. I don't believe he gets into bed at night and says to his wife when negotiations break down, damn it, I really, really, really wanted to conclude this deal, but it looks like, I think he's more like, say, darling, we managed to kick the can down the road another 5 years, you know, all is well. I've never detected, and we all know where his father stood, what kind of background he comes from. I have never detected in Prime Minister Netanyahu much genuine eagerness, desire to reach a two-state outcome. He did, of course, make the speech that President Obama pretty much demanded of him 6 years ago, talking about two states for the first time. It's still not in the official Likud manifesto, the manifesto of the party he comes from. I mean, Likud has not adopted a two-state outcome as an objective. Short answer to the question, no. I don't believe there is a genuine interest, which is why I thought the last election was so important. I thought that with the Prime Minister Herzog, you weren't going to get a radically different view, say, on Iran. But I do think you would have gotten a Prime Minister whose interest was genuine, at least, in trying to do this very difficult thing. And I don't think that exists with Prime Minister Netanyahu. And I think the point just made about the growing right-wing constituency in Israel, which has also been fed into, of course, by the large influx of Russian Jews who tend also to be on the right of the political spectrum. All that for people like myself or NIF, this is worrying.
There are a couple of other really good questions about this issue. One is how much, given Israel is already a multinational state that seems to sometimes be working okay, sometimes not. Others about what circumstances or conditions need to be created in the West Bank in order to avoid what happened in Gaza. Another is what the centre-left can do in Israel in order to boost their chances of electoral success. I think we might move on. So I just wanted to say, give a quick plug that on the 21st of September, on Monday, the 21st of September in Sydney, Martin Indyk, who's the former US Special Envoy for Israeli-Palestinian negotiations, will be giving a talk for NIF in Sydney. We're going to be releasing details of that this week. And so hopefully we can deal with a lot more of these questions as they come up. So that's Monday, the 21st of September in Sydney. So I wanted to move on to another issue that you write a lot about.
Yeah, can I just say one thing on that? I mean, just very briefly before we move on. I think, you know, the way forward is not, it's not dreamland. You know, there was Prime Minister Fayyad, Salam Fayyad, in the West Bank, did some pretty amazing things in terms of cleaning up governance. He basically said, if we want a state, let's make a state. You know, enough blah, blah, enough narrative. You don't put food on the table with narrative. You don't put food on the table by being indignant. If we want a state, let's show the world we can build a state. And for the first time, there were new residential developments. A cinema opened on the West Bank. As I said, governance was going up. What was the reaction on both sides to Prime Minister Fayyad? I think on the Israeli side, it was, oh my gosh, here's a Palestinian who speaks perfect English, who's presentable, who was educated at the University of Texas, who's worked in international financial institutions, who's a credible interlocutor. He's the Palestinian from hell, because he's going to make people think, well, there actually could be a Palestinian state, and it doesn't need to be led by extremists. It could be led by people like Salam Fayyad, who believes absolutely in two states for two peoples living beside each other in peace and security. And what was the reaction of Fatah and of President Abbas? It was, Fayyad is not a member of Fatah. We have some nice, sweet deals here, nepotism, cronyism. He's probably going to clean up all that. So they kept Prime Minister Fayyad, then Prime Minister Fayyad, at a distance. Look, with reasonable people on both sides and real desire on both sides. We all know what, more or less, what the outline of a two-state, this is not nuclear science. We know more or less what it would look like. But the painful sacrifices on both sides have to be made on issues like Palestinian refugees, on issues like Jerusalem. But they can be made if there's the will. And we saw with Fayyad very clearly on both sides that there just hasn't been, isn't sufficient will.
There's kind of a couple more questions that have come out, so we might just talk for on one last issue about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict.
Yeah. And that's about, sorry, I slightly derailed.
It's good. People are interested, so I think.
I do think that the whole Fayyad saga is very instructive.
So one of the issues that I think also undermines that is the issue of settlement expansion. And so there's a question, I'll read it out verbatim and I guess you can decide which parts of it to address. So Robin asks, the Zionist leadership in Australia and AJAC, which is our local equivalent of APAC, constantly assert that settlements have not been expanding geographically and that everyone knows there'll be a swap as part of a final settlement, which keeps 80% of settlers inside Israel, and therefore settlements aren't a real obstacle to peace. And so Robin asks, are the settlements in fact expanding geographically? And I don't know how much you can speak to that, but to what degree would you say and to tell the Australian community why they are in fact an obstacle to peace and why this continues to undermine that kind of moderate leadership that you're talking about?
Did AJAC deliberately set out to rhyme with APAC, or is that just because?
It's a good question. I think so, but it stands for different things, but it's a good question.
Okay. Look, I think it's true to say that most of the settlement growth is building within the settlements that already exist, adding new units. But I think there's also some geographical, certainly there has been over the years, as we know, a lot of geographical expansion. It doesn't really matter, you know, at this point, what the fine print is. What Palestinians see is more and more people living west, east of the 1967 line, more and more settlers. And they say to themselves something, it's psychological, it's a very basic thing. These guys, some of them anyway, say they're prepared to accept a state for us, a homeland for the Palestinians. But hang on a second, they're building the whole time. There are more and more of them living where this purported state, possible state, putative state is going to be. And it's a very visceral reaction that you see, not only on the part of the Palestinian leadership, but also just Palestinians you run into when you travel in the West Bank. This is the single most emotive issue. And of course it is, because if you look at the geography of the West Bank these days, you tend to see kind of modern garrisons on hills around the place. And these garrison-like structures are, in general, settlements. So it inhabits the minds and imaginations of Palestinians. They feel themselves more and more ringed by the settlements. Now, it's true to say that those closest to Jerusalem, closest to Israel proper, west of the 1967 lines, there's been a lot of discussion of the fact that, or the idea that, it's not a fact, the idea that these would remain part of Israel in any settlement against territorial exchanges. But, you know, these are still ideas. This isn't resolved. So I think people who say, to answer the question just bluntly, people who say that the settlements are not an issue, they're a non-issue, that's wrong. They're an issue, they're a big issue. And I think any negotiation has to take place in a framework where settlement expansion of any kind, whether territorial or just in the number of settlers, number of units, is frozen. Because it's a sign of seriousness. That's what it comes down to. It's a sign of, okay, you know, this is delicate politically, it's tough politically, but we're going to do it because we want to show you that we're serious. Now, you show us that you're serious. Stop some of the incitement against Jews in the Palestinian media. Stop the incitement in newspapers. Stop raising Palestinians to hate Jews. You be serious too, and we'll be serious.
I think those are very good lessons to take out of it. One thing I do want to talk about, I really want to leave you a chance to talk a little bit about your latest book, which for anyone who's read, I'm sure will agree, is a fascinating read. So just before that, I wanted to talk about something that you have a deep interest in, and that's the future of Jewish life in Europe. And so some would say that with extremist Islamist groups and Islamist terror on the rise, particularly in continental Europe, and also with the rise of far-right nationalist parties gaining ground and also with sympathies for them increasing, some would say that there's no future for Jews in Europe, either encouraging them to leave elsewhere or particularly to go to Israel. And so I wanted to hear what you thought of that and what your reflections were.
I don't agree that there's no future for Jews in Europe. And if that became the case, I think really all bets are off. Jewish life is intrinsic to European history. And if 70 years after the Holocaust, you had a situation where the surviving Jews of Europe, the Jews who stayed in Europe and who managed to stay there despite Hitler's attempt to annihilate Jewish life in Europe, supported, as we know, tacitly or explicitly by many of the governments of the time, including the Vichy French government, if you had a situation 70 years on where you had massive exodus of the Jews of Europe, I really think, Liam, at that point, all bets are off and the world would be hurtling toward civilizational confrontation and probably war on a massive scale. So I don't want to even think that might happen. That said, we're not in the 1930s, but I do think the situation is more tense. I don't want to generalize. I don't think it's more tense everywhere. I don't think it's more tense really in Britain. But in a country like France, yes, where the largest Jewish community in Europe lives. Why? Because there have been a series of attacks. There's the attack on Jewish kids in Toulouse a couple of years back. And of course, we had the whole terrible in January attack, first of all, on Charlie Hebdo, the satirical newspaper, for its cartoons and mocking of the Prophet Muhammad, And then a couple of days later, the attack on the kosher supermarket at the Porte de Vincennes and the killing of four Jews there. So the Jewish community in France is on edge. It's worried. Parents are dropping their kids off at schools that are heavily guarded. Prominent Jews in France have police protection. And it's a worrying situation. And you also have the largest Muslim community in Europe in France. And the two communities are, the Muslims of France say they're victims of Islamophobia, that there's a lot of prejudice against them, they can't make their way. And the Jews of France feel they've been attacked. And a lot of the left in France and some of the media blame them or blame Israel for just about anything. So there's a lot of ugly myth-making going around on both sides. And we had the incident on the train the other day where, thanks to three young Americans, a pretty hideous attack potentially was averted. So my answer to your question is, it's worrying, particularly in France and Belgium. And you'll have more Jews leaving France for Israel, or maybe for the Upper West Side right here in New York, or for London, or even Australia maybe, than you've had at any time in recent years. And if there was another major attack, you would have a very, very tense situation. But I think people have got to keep their heads and not exaggerate. We're not in the 1930s.
So there's a great question from Miriam in the Q&A, which I want to ask you, and that's, what, if any, is the impact of the rise of anti-Semitism and Islamic extremism in Europe? What's the impact of that on Israel and the peace process, if any?
I think it's more the other way around, Miriam. I think it's the impact of the AMPAS and low-level violence wars in Israel-Palestine on the situation in Europe. I think every time there's a flare-up like the Gaza war, you have the situation in Europe becoming, there's a spillover, the poison seeps into Europe, and you have these hideous, terrible things happening. Even in Germany, where I lived for 3 years as correspondent in Berlin, if you told me when I lived there in the late 1990s that you'd have people in the streets of German cities saying Jews are pigs, as occurred at the time of the last Gaza war, I said, you're crazy, but it's happening. So there's no question that so long as there are flare-ups in the Middle East, that seeps into Europe in the worst possible way and exacerbates all the tensions between large Muslim communities and Jews in Europe. Whether it goes the other way, I'm not sure. I mean, the whole dynamic is not helpful at all, and nor is it. Another element in all this that we haven't mentioned is the emergence of ISIS, this barbaric, murderous, jihadi group that has been beheading non-believers, beheading Christians, killing journalists, raping women en masse, enslaving children. And this has proved to have some appeal to not tens of thousands, but thousands of young Muslims in Britain, in France, in Belgium, in Germany. You've seen a significant trickle of young Muslims in Europe who feel alienated. We don't have time to go into all the reasons. And clearly, they're in some way unstable, I think, these kids, to be drawn to these kinds of ideas in the first place. And then they come back. And the attack in Belgium was perpetrated by somebody who'd come back from that ISIS theater in Syria and Iraq. So there's a whole dynamic that's very troubling.
I think this idea around Islamic State would have been very interesting to delve into, but like you said, unfortunately, we don't have time. So the last thing I did want to ask you to talk a little bit about was your latest book, The Girl from Human Street, which is the story of your mother and her battle with mental illness and mental illnesses in families everywhere. And there's also a very interesting story about Jewish migration and Jewish values and reflections on your time living in apartheid South Africa, and also the time that you've spent in Israel and in the UK. So I wanted you to talk a little bit about how you came to write the book and why it was important to tell the story. And then there's a question specifically about South African Jewry, which I'd like you to talk about, but perhaps first the book.
Well, thank you, Liam. Yeah, you know, I've been a foreign correspondent most of my life, a newspaper man for a long time, and running around from dateline to dateline, covering wars in Lebanon and Bosnia, conflicts in South America. And I just reached a point where I thought, first of all, was the most dangerous dateline for me was myself and turning my gaze inward. And then I was often dealing with the people who'd been uprooted, who'd been displaced, who'd been pushed out. I mean, my family and its hopping, global hopping, had managed to avoid the Holocaust and avoid major conflagrations. But and I'd been raised in Britain pretty much to think that, you know, I'd been in Britain since 1066. And I began to think about my own story, my grandparents from Lithuania and great-grandparents, their migration to South Africa, my parents born in Johannesburg, the whole story of South African Jewry and apartheid. And then my parents, my dad, the doctor, hated apartheid, had come to Britain at the end of World War II, worked as a young doctor, saw wider horizons in Europe for medicine, the medicine he was interested in. So then they, in the 50s, migrate in turn again to Britain. And then I became an American citizen, as I mentioned. And part of my family was Zionist and went from South Africa to Israel. And I started thinking about this story of continuous repetitive displacement and its psychological impact. You know, in the United States, we think of immigration as new hope, new opportunity. That's the American dream. You come, you make your way. And it's true, there is that. That's the bright star of repetitive displacement. But its black sun, if you like, if we're honest, is loss. You leave something behind. You have to start again. Lots of Jews have done it in Australia, and they've been very successful. But it's not always easy. It can be painful. And you forget. You forget maybe parts of your Jewish identity. Maybe you forget all of your Jewish identity. I mean, my family didn't change its name. We knew we were Jews, but I was raised pretty much without any observance of Jewish tradition. That was, in fact, when my father left South Africa, a cousin of his called him in and said, "Darling, you're going to Britain. You really got to change your name. You're never going to make it there." It was a Cohen. And he said, "Well, really? Okay. Let me think about it." And he went away, and then he went back to see her, and she said, "Well, darling, what did you decide?" And he said, "Well, I've been thinking about it, and you're right. You know, it's painful, but I really must change my name." And she said, "Oh, that's wonderful, darling. What to?" And he said, "Einstein." So that was the end of that particular discussion. And I thought about all this, what I've just mentioned, particularly in the context of my mother, because my mother died in 1999. 16 years ago, but my great-grandfather, Isaac Michael, who came from Lithuania, and I found his records, he went to London, and then he traveled age 17 from Southampton to Cape Town, and under profession, age 17, he put prospector. So he was always somebody who thought big, and he ended up being a co-founder after many tribulations and many meanderings. He became the co-founder of the Macy's. I don't know what the equivalent in Australia is, but the big department store in South Africa was called the OK Bazaars. So he was a co-founder of this. He ended his life on this big estate in Johannesburg. It was known as Chateau Michael. And my mother grew up in this world of extraordinary South African Jewish prosperity, created more or less overnight. Jews were the right color in South Africa. And Isaac Michael was a very shrewd businessman. And then she was plucked out of this into post-war Britain, putting coins in the meter for hot water. There was still rationing when she arrived there. She was pregnant with my younger sister. And my mother cracked up after my sister was born. And she had what was then called post-puerperal psychosis, now generally called postpartum depression. And she was in and out of psychiatric institutions for a couple of years when I was aged between 2 and 4. And then this was never talked about in the family. So I felt there were two related things that I wanted to explore. I mean, one was my family's story, which had never really been talked about, where we came from, who was I, and then my mother's particular story. And why do I say related? Because I think that the psychological impact, would my mother have cracked up in South Africa? I don't know. I can't prove it either way. I know she was very comfortable there, and toward the end of her life, she always wanted to go back there. And I know her breakdown occurred, her first breakdown, when she got to Britain. And I think there's a link between that kind of trauma of upheaval and mental illness, mental breakdown. And in the case of my mother, I think she was a transplant who didn't take. It was too much for her. And so in The Girl from Human Street, I trace my family story, and then I managed also through Britain's Freedom of Information Act to find some of my mother's records. I relate in the book what happened to my mother. And of course, this was difficult. It was painful. People maybe asked me, you know, why would you want to know? Well, I guess I was made that way. But I also think in general, it's better for things to be aired, to be known. And the book was an odyssey. It's an odyssey for the reader, and it was for me.
I think we're very grateful that you're able to tell the story, because I know that I very much found it very interesting to read, and I very much enjoyed, and I guess, seeing you go on that journey. I've as a reader, I appreciate it. I know others did too. And I wanted to pivot to this very interesting question about South African jury. And so the question is that the South African Board, which you explore in the book, the South African Board of Deputies did not officially condemn apartheid until 1985, and many consider that a moral failure of leadership, a failure by the Jewish community to stand up for others subject to racism and discrimination. And would you agree that there is a similar moral failure of leadership in Jewish communities that are keeping shtum about the xenophobia and ill treatment of predominantly Muslim asylum seekers in, I think this is a particular reflection in Australia, but against not wanting to speak up about xenophobia and racism more generally when it's not carried out against Jews?
Well, I think Jews, given their history, given the fact that through so much of our history we were strangers in strange lands, given that the most fundamental teachings of Judaism say that which is hateful to yourself, do not do to your fellow man, given that really we came up with the idea of, we the Jews came up with the idea of a formless, faceless God to whom we were bound by what? We were bound, as I understand it, essentially through an ethical covenant. And that was the covenant, an ethical covenant, that we dragged around the world with us over millennia. And it's really what held us together as a people. And if that covenant only proves valid, applicable, operational, in situations of Jewish hardship, where we're the strangers in strange lands, and not when we Jews, as in Israel today, are in a position of power, I think that would be a very sad and regrettable outcome. So I would say that as a general observation. You know, more specifically, I think, yes, in South Africa, there was a failure of the South African Board of Deputies. I relate in the book how a Rabbi Ungar arrived in the mid-1950s, and he had been a young Jew in Budapest during World War II, and he suddenly sees benches on which blacks cannot sit, parks into which blacks cannot go, beaches to which blacks have no right, train cars that are for blacks, others that are for whites. And of course, what does he see? He sees park benches in Budapest on which Jews couldn't sit. He sees the Star of David and the star that he was obliged to wear, and that kept him from vast areas of his home city where he was no longer allowed to go. So Anunga stood up, talked about this, and he was shunned by the Board of Deputies. He was expelled after a year or so by the South African government, and the Board of Deputies said not a word. That said, there were some brave rabbis who stood up and were counted. And look, I mean, I've covered enough conflicts to know that most people in situations where there is personal risk maybe risk of life even. I don't think that was the case in South Africa, there was risk of life, but there was personal risk, possibly of being exiled by the nationalist government in standing up against apartheid. Most people do remain stum. They go along. A significant number of people do not, and that is the hope of humanity, if you like, that there are people who will not accept gross injustice that is occurring before their eyes. This happened in South Africa. It took a long time for the Board of Deputies, and by the time it did change its position, the winds of change were already blowing across South Africa, and you could see the direction in which things were going. I talk in my book about one member of my family, an aunt of mine, who joined the Black Sash and really worked hard against apartheid. My father left, my uncle left, they couldn't abide apartheid. But a lot of people went along, and the official jury in South Africa, if you like. And people always say, you know, how is it possible? How is it possible that the worst things happen? Well, it's possible because of that. You know, it's possible because people, not enough people, say no.
So I think we'll finish there. There was a question about exactly the name of the book. The name of the book's The Girl from Human Street.
The girl, I should just explain, the girl is my mother. She was born on Human, technically Human Street, probably, in a small town, in South Africa called Krugersdorp, near Johannesburg, which, as your listeners probably know, was the richest seam of gold ever discovered in the world, was found on the reef in Johannesburg in the 1880s, and that led to the birth of Johannesburg, and then a number of smaller towns, a little lower down the reef, like Krugersdorp, grew up, and my mother was born there on Human Street. So she is the girl from Human Street.
And so you can buy that book. I know I bought the book on my Kindle on the Amazon store, and I know that it's in a lot of bookstores around both Melbourne and Sydney. So definitely encourage people to go. And hopefully Roger will be able to come out to Australia next year and he can sign it for you in person. And so I think that would be a nice thing. So we'll wrap up. Roger, thank you very, very much for coming out. For those who have been particularly observant, you'll see in the background it's gone from dark to light. And so Roger woke up very early for us this morning. We're very, very grateful. So thank you so much for taking the time.
I'm absolutely determined to make it to Australia.
Well, we're determined to bring you out. So we're hoping that next year at some point we'll be able to make it happen. Like I said, in Sydney on the 21st of September, Monday the 21st of September, Martin Indyk will be giving a talk for NIF in Sydney. Stay tuned to your emails and to our website, to nif.org.au. The last thing I really wanted to say was that we're very grateful for all the support that we receive from our supporters and from participants in this webinar. So we'd certainly encourage you, in order to support our work in Israel and to support us to continue to have conversations like this one, to go online and give a donation to NIF Australia. So again, our website is nif.org.au. Thank you everyone again for coming. Thank you again to Roger. And we look forward to seeing you again soon. This webinar will be up on YouTube sometime tomorrow, so you can share it with your friends. Thank you again, Roger, and have a good night and a good day to you.
Thank you very much. What time is it there?
It's 9:10 in the evening.
All right. Okay, so we're at different stages of our days. Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Okay. Have a good one. Yeah. Okay, bye.